Das weiter, Grüße der Gäste, good evening and welcome to Hay. We're delighted to welcome the Inspire Literature and Environment Lecture back again. It's the sixth year now. This has been a collaboration which myself and Jane Davison crafted over a beer 6 years ago with this idea of providing the winner of the lecture the opportunity to come here and speak at Hay. And so, yes, it's about the sixth year. It's a collaboration between Inspire, Asley and Hay Festival, and we are delighted to welcome both the people from Inspire and Asley, and also the winner. The winner was Helen Moore. She will be signing copies of her poetry books in the bookshop afterwards. But please do welcome to stage Helen Moore, Jane Davidson, and Brooke and Carey.
Hello, good evening. We are the Rainbringers. So, thank you very much, Andy. My name is Jane Davidson, and as Andy was saying, I'm the director of Inspire, which is the Institute for Sustainable Practice, Innovation and Resource Effectiveness at the University of Wales, Trinity St David. And I'm really delighted to be joined by Professor Brooke and Carey, Professor of English at Northumbria University, who is the chair of ASLEY, the Study of Literature and the Environment. And when we started 6 years ago, looking at the creation of this lecture, one of the key things, I think, for Inspire and for ASLEY was that how could we open up an amazing opportunity where people who had major academic credentials could be really creative around literature and the environment, and in doing so, translate that to the public. And so putting together this idea of a public lecture was imaginative. As Andy says from Hay Festival, we're now in our sixth year, and we're not aware that there is any other either competition or opportunity like this in this context. So I am really delighted that we have Helen Moore with us. Over the few years that we have been operating the competition, we've had such varied inputs. As the first year, we had Aberystwyth University scholars who found out that Shakespeare was a grain hoarder and a tax dodger, and that he died the richest man in Stratford. And it came out at a timely political moment and actually merited a leader in the Times. So with a small but perfectly formed audience, we had 3 million hits across the world. But we've had a whole range of participants, people who've looked at nature writing and writing and making the ordinary extraordinary, particularly Richard Kerridge of Bath Spa University and his love of amphibians. Hayden Gabriel from St. Mark and St. John University, looking at how we can support future generations of human beings and also the richer way of animals that live alongside us. Hugh Dunkerley, another poet, spoke on poetry and fracking. And last year, we had Rachel Dowes on Starling Song, Murmurations of Meaning. And that was sort of extraordinary again in the idea that something so ordinary as the starlings outside our houses that can be shooed away from our bird tables are beautiful and inspiring with a long cultural and linguistic heritage. And this year, we are really privileged to have Helen Moore with us. I was interested in talking to Helen over lunch and found that she had initially started life as wanting to be a novelist, but the publisher she approached suggested that her writing was too anti-consumerist for the market, so that attracted me to her immediately. Her first poetry was in 2012, Hedge Fund and Other Living Margins, and her second poetry collection, Ecozoa, when she went back to the same publisher, he said that was too political and polemical, so she had to change publisher. But that hasn't stopped her from the third collection, The Mother Country, which will be coming out spring. I also asked her, what started her on this. And she said that as a toddler, she actually still remembers touching an earwig on a fence and having a shock from the pronged hawk. And ever since then, and time with grandparents, time in the countryside, has brought her to where she is now. And as you'll see in a moment, she has the most incredible masters, or is it mistressy, of words. And Helen, please give us your amazing lecture, Is Love the Answer? Personal and planetary well-being through the lens of poetry. So ladies and gentlemen, Helen Moore. We float in oceans of information, some of which may be fake news, but which is, for the most part, credibly documented bad news. A great deal of this pertains to ill health, both human and planetary. Plastic-filled oceans, deforestation, soil erosion, bleaching coral reefs, melting ice caps, rising sea levels, and such a rate of biodiversity loss that scientists are now describing this period in the Earth's history as the sixth mass extinction. At the same time, World Health Organization statistics indicate that global levels of obesity have nearly tripled since 1975. Linked to this, heart disease is now the number one cause of death worldwide, with cancer coming in second and new cancer cases expected to rise by about 70% over the next 20 years. In many Western countries, mental disorders are currently the leading cause of disability, responsible for 30 to 40% of chronic sick leave. And among 15 to 29-year-olds, suicide, tragically, is now the second leading cause of death. For the founder of eco-psychology, Theodore Rosak, the human and the planetary are inextricably linked. In The Voice of the Earth, he writes, when in obedience to a narrow reality principle, we make the non-human world less than it is, we also make ourselves less than we are. More of the mind is split off and driven into that zone of impermissible experience called insane. Often, that so-called insanity can involve seeing things, hearing things that the conventional reality principle insists are not there. And in this regard, Rosak evokes the connection that indigenous people have with the natural world. In tribal societies, there is very much more to see and hear. The mountain speaks, the bear speaks, the river speaks, the rainbow signifies, the eclipse is a sign. Citing the ethical restraint upon exploitation and abuse that this kind of worldview provides, he points to the animistic sensibility of our own ancestors and asks whether its loss accounts not only for our ecological crisis, but also for our crazy-making discontent. For the American poet, Gary Snyder, our ecological crisis is a problem of love. Not the humanistic love of the West, but a love that extends to animals, rocks, dirt, all of it. Without this love, he says, we can end with an uninhabitable place. But could love really be the answer for restoring human and planetary well-being? And if so, what kind of love? Unlike the ancient Greeks, for whom notions of love were nuanced through various words, we are limited in our lexicon. In the Wonder Box, Curious Histories of How to Live, Roman Knazarik talks how English has a single word to do the job of encompassing erotic love, love of friends, family, spouse, children, a spectrum across which the Greeks distinguished with eros, philia, ludus, agape, pragma, and philautia. Interestingly, however, these distinct types of love relate ostensibly to other humans. How then can we describe love that extends beyond an anthropocentric perspective? Biophilia, which borrows the Greek bio, life, and philia, brotherly love or affectionate friendship, denotes love of life or living systems. The term was coined by Eric Fromm, writing in The Heart of Man in 1964, to describe a psychological orientation towards all that is alive and vital. The American biologist E.O. Wilson then used it to describe his biophilia hypothesis, suggesting that humans possess an innate urge to affiliate with other forms of life. In one of my own poems, entitled Green Drift, I revel in this as I describe experiences of foraging wild garlic. High on spring, I'm a biophile and incurable, nor would I care for any cure, would only be a node in great mother's body. Since I greatly enjoy being in woodlands, I could also describe myself as a nemophilist, a now obscure word, which derives from the Greek nemos, grove, and philos, affection. And yet, accessing woods and green spaces is increasingly challenging for people. More than half the world's population is now urban, and according to the UN, that proportion is expected to increase to 66% by 2050. Children are growing up with limited contact with the natural world, as documented by Richard Louv in his book, Last Child in the Woods, where he coined the phrase nature deficit disorder. This has been shown to affect young people's well-being and development in multiple ways. For example, compared with young nemophilists who regularly run around in woodlands, children who have only ever walked on pavements and tarmac have a poorer sense of balance. Unfamiliarity with the natural world can also lead to the opposite of biophilia, people developing phobias, such as towards touching soil. And this is ironic when studies published in the journal Neuroscience show that when human skin connects with certain soil bacteria, serotonin is released in the brain, actually making us feel better. But can poetry help us reconnect with our innate biophilia? The Canadian poet Tim Lilburn thinks so. In an essay in Living in the World as If It Were Home, he writes, poetry is where we go when we want to know the world as lover. And for Lilburn, This is erotic love. Poetry seems to be the speech of a desire, a love, an eros for union with the world, building from all. Such awe is powerfully conveyed in Heathcote Williams's long poem, Falling for a Dolphin, in which he describes diving in a remote cove in the southwest of Ireland with the intention of meeting a hermit dolphin known to live there. Initially, there is reserve in their encounter as the poet, alone in the sea, is aware of the creature's power. And it could stave in your body with a lackadaisical flick of its fin, torpedo into you at 30 knots, snapping your spine as if it were a sardine's. But its demeanor and 3-foot smile, a tender-lipped antidote to panic, reassure the poet, and they begin to communicate and explore each other. It touches your cheek, nuzzling your skin, then moves away with a glance that seems to invite you to stroll horizontally in a direction of its choosing. You accept, magnetically allured by a very complete stranger, willingly locked into its company. Spending time with the wild dolphin sparks thoughts in the poet about evolution, shared ancestry, and what it is to be human. Unexpectedly carried on the dolphin's back to the safety of the rocky shoreline, the poet then reflects on how the encounter has affected him. Drawn into the dolphin's force field, smitten by the shamanistic glimmer in an eye that distills a lifelong exposure to another rarer state of things, you too are alchemically touched. Reading Falling for a Dolphin, I feel more curious about the lives of marine creatures and greatly moved. Such opening of readers to new thoughts and feelings is part of poetry's alchemical effect. This can be reinforced through the music of a poem, which embeds it in our memories, our bodies. Natural alchemy also features in Kathleen Raine's poem, Amo Ergo Sum. The Latin phrase, meaning I love, therefore I am, neatly subverts a fundamental idea in Western philosophy derived from René Descartes' Cogito ergo sum, I think, therefore I am. For the poet, it is not thinking that defines her sense of self, but rather the act of loving, which simultaneously reinforces the sacredness of the natural phenomena she describes and a felt sense of interconnection with the cosmos. Because I love, the sun pours out its rays of living gold, pours out its gold and silver on the sea. Because I love, the earth upon her astral spindle winds, her ecstasy producing dance. Raine's litany of love, each stanza insistently beginning with the refrain, because I love, culminates in the final verse, where a state of complete peace is reached. Because I love, all night long the river flows into my sleep. 10,000 living things are sleeping in my arms, and sleeping wake and flowing are at rest. Our interconnection with all beings, human and other than human, is also expressed in Kin, Anne Elvey's second eco-poetry collection. In a poem entitled Plural Ecstatic, sensual and erotic love surface at different moments through the course of a day. Interestingly, the poem begins with AM love, which suggests both the morning time and a self identifying with love. In this moment, we then see the biophilic body autonomously seeking connection with the elements. AM love. The body lusts for the light. The sky's blonde fringe falls across a face you could stroke with your eyes. Transcending any self-imposed will to remain working indoors, this biophilic longing returns and seemingly turns the speaker inside out. Afternoon love, the wind lifts your hair with rumor of a place other than your screen. You unbutton your skin. Elvie writes, rumor of a place other than your screen. But am I alone in observing a growing trend for screensavers displaying natural imagery, as if software designers were tacitly acknowledging our innate biophilia and by offering a simulacrum seek further to distract us? Insights expressed by the modern poets quoted here connect with the Romantic tradition, which arose in reaction to a rapidly industrializing society where human misery and environmental pollution went hand in hand. Upholding the belief that a close connection with nature was mentally and morally healthy, poets such as William Blake and William Wordsworth clearly saw threads connecting us to earlier societies where a more animistic worldview prevailed. What can poetry from these pre-literate societies reveal? An entirely oral phenomenon shared through folk memory, poetry was not the specialized art form it has become. Instead, it overlapped with a variety of functions required by the community, including healing. In Technicians of the Sacred, Jerome Rothenberg's collection of ethno-poetic texts gathered from predominantly oral cultures around the world, we find an Anglo-Saxon herbal charm. Recorded initially by Christian monks, their revisions have altered its text to include biblical references, but it survives with pagan elements intact. Apparently, an antidote to snakebite, the nine herbs charm reveals both magical and, I believe, biophilic worldviews, where plants we nowadays dismiss as weeds are revered for their healing properties. And you, plantain, mother of herbs, open to the east, mighty within. Chariots creaked over you, queens have ridden over you, brides have moaned over you. Over you, bulls gnashed their teeth. All these you did withstand and resist, so may you withstand poison and infection and the foe who fares through the land. Alluding to Odin, the Norse god associated with healing, death, and poetry, amongst other things, the poem describes how Woden responds to a man's snakebite by gathering nine glorious herbs, each cited in the poem. The recipe for this divinely directed antidote concludes the poem. And here it is. Crush the herbs to dust, mix with the soap and the apple's juice, make a paste of water and ashes, take fennel, boil it in the paste and bathe with egg moisture, either before or after he puts on the salve. Sing this charm on each of the herbs, three times before he works them together, and on the apple also, and sing the same charm into the man's mouth and into both his ears and into the wound before he puts on the salve. More than 1,000 years later, Wilfred Owen turned to Greek mythology to express his sense of the earth as a source of personal power whilst recovering from shell shock sustained serving on the front line in 1917. Written while at Craig Lockhart Military Psychiatric Hospital near Edinburgh, his poem fragment, The Wrestlers, draws on the story of the wrestling match between Hercules, and Antaeus, son of Poseidon and Gaia, sea and earth, an invisible half-giant who challenged passers-by to wrestling matches. Antaeus's source of power is beautifully expressed in these lines. How earth herself empowered him by her touch, gave him the grip and stringency of winter and all the ardor of the invincible spring. How all the blood of June glutted his heart and the wild glow of huge autumnal storms stirred on his face and flickered from his eyes. Eventually, understanding why Antaeus has remained invincible for so long, Hercules is able to defeat him by lifting him off the ground and crushing him in a deadly bear hug. In a piece written under a pseudonym in the Hydra, the hospital's in-house magazine, Owen clearly indicates how he identifies with Antaeus. Now, surely every officer who comes to Craig Lockhart recognizes that in a way, he himself is Antaeus, who has been taken from his mother earth and well nigh crushed to death by the war giant or military machine. Tragically, of course, having been rehabilitated through Craig Lockhart's nature cure regime, Owen was returned to the front line and killed in action just days before the armistice was signed. Hercules had indeed won. The practice of nature cure has resurfaced strongly in recent years through ecotherapy, which seeks to support people's recovery from mental ill health with a range of outdoor-based programs, including woodland conservation and gardening. However, as industrial activity continues to pressure ecosystems, green spaces can no longer be relied upon to offer bucolic scenes that induce positive emotions in the onlooker, and polluted or otherwise damaged natural environments can compound or even provoke feelings of despair and depression. Indicative of this is the shift in how we understand the term pastoral, a mode of poetry that was once frequently employed to celebrate the virtues of rural life. It now often carries a pejorative sense, connoting work that ignores the material and social realities of this existence. In the work of John Clare, the Northamptonshire poet who suffered rural poverty and the harsh effects of the Enclosure Acts during the first half of the 19th century, we can see an early exponent of what we might call wounded pastoral. Having lovingly described the commonly owned land in and around his native village of Helpston in his early poems, Clare was then forced to participate in fencing off this land so it could pass into private ownership, an experience which no doubt contributed to his mental illness. In The Moors, Claire evokes his beloved pre-enclosure landscape. Far spread the moory ground, a level scene bespread with rush and one eternal green that never felt the rage of blundering plough. Those centuries wreathe spring's blossoms on its brow, still meeting plains that stretch them far away in unchecked shadows of green, brown, and grey. Unbounded freedom ruled the wandering scene, nor fence of ownership crept in between to hide the prospect of the following eye. Its only bondage was the circling sky. And in the same poem, Claire shows enclosure's impact not just on people, but also on wildlife. Enclosure came and trampled on the grave of labor's rights and left the poor a slave, and birds and trees and flowers without a name all sighed when lawless laws enclosure came. How can we face nature's inescapable brokenness, which reflects our own, without going mad? Again, I believe poetry can show us a way. Here is London Rain by Kathleen Rain. The diamond spheres tainted from poisoned air that blows about the houses. Each sour raindrop hanging from wire or railings yet catches its ray to open the rainbow light of heavenly promise before it falls on sterile ground to moisten the patient moss that mends with living green of paradise, springing from blown dust in cracks and crevices for lonely, downcast eyes to find a long ago familiar place. Different in style, but similar in its attunement to the sacred in a damaged world, is Allen Ginsberg's Sunflower Sutra. Here, Ginsberg describes how he and fellow beat poet Jack Kerouac arrive in a state of grief and weariness at an industrial dockland beside San Francisco Bay and sit in the shade of a large Southern Pacific locomotive to watch the sunset. Around them, they observe the gnarled steel roots of trees and machinery, as well as rubbish and oil-polluted waters devoid of life. Yet amidst this bleak landscape, they discover a tall sunflower growing from a pile of sawdust. And the grey sunflower, poised against the sunset, crackly, bleak and dusty with a smut and smog and smoke of olden locomotive in its eye. Despite its imperfect state, it inspires a sense of reverence. Unholy, battered old thing you were, my sunflower, oh my soul, I loved you then. Perceiving a beauty that transcends the grime and misery of modern civilization, the poet is moved to see it as a mirror for the inner beauty of all humans who share the same debilitating environment. We're not our skin of grime. We're not our dread, bleak, dusty, imageless locomotive. We're all golden sunflowers inside, blessed by our own seed and hairy, naked accomplishment bodies, growing into mad black formal sunflowers in the sunset, spied on by our eyes under the shadow of the mad locomotive riverbank sunset, Frisco hilly tin can evening, sit down vision. this word vision with which Ginsberg ends Sunflower Sutra is one that many modern poets shy from. Yet the need for vision remains central to religious traditions, to indigenous people's survival, and, interestingly enough, in business, to the success of corporations. Referencing the Christian Bible, the Ogala Sioux holy man known as Black Elk famously reminds us, without a vision, the people perish. Is it possible then that in spite of the bleakness inside and outside ourselves at this time of enormous crisis on planet Earth, we may, out of deep biophilic love for ourselves and the wild plants and creatures with whom we interdepend, discover and champion healthier ways of living and being. Personally, I draw great inspiration from fellow poets who, although fully aware of the challenges we face, are willing to share their personal sense of a future in which all beings can thrive. A fine example is the work of the American farmer poet, Wendell Berry. Here is his poem, A Vision. If we will have the wisdom to survive, to stand like slow-growing trees on a ruined place, renewing, enriching it. If we make our seasons welcome here, asking not too much of earth or heaven, then a long time after we are dead, the lives our lives prepare will live here. Their houses strongly placed upon the valley sides, fields and gardens rich in the windows. The river will run clear as we will never know it, and over it birdsong like a canopy. On the levels of the hills will be green meadows, stock bells in noonshade. On the steeps where greed and ignorance cut down the old forest, an old forest will stand, its rich leafful drifting its roots. The veins of forgotten springs will have opened. Families will be singing in their fields. In the voices, they will hear a music risen out of the ground. They will take nothing from the ground. They will not return, whatever the grief at parting. Memory, native to this valley, will spread over it like a grove. And memory will grow into a legend, legend into song, song into sacrament. The abundance of this place, the songs of its people and its birds will be health and wisdom and indwelling light. This is no paradisal dream. Its hardship is its possibilities. Wendell Berry's line, "The lives our lives prepare," speaks strongly to me. How does our work serve the kind of future we would like to co-create? An aspect of my vision is a future where young people are deeply connected with nature, not just eco-literate, i.e. knowing the names of the flora and fauna around them, but where they are also regularly involved in renewing and enriching the ecosystems in which they live and learn. A reciprocal process that simultaneously nourishes their well-being. To conclude, I'd like to share a poem from Ecozoa, my second collection, which draws on my experience working over several years as a forest school leader. Here is a natural curriculum. I am child-free. but have a dozen children who come to me for help, comfort. A soft, skinned hand in mine, unshaped by experience, yet eager to feel, to learn. That 300-year-old beach standing taller than a church. What history has it witnessed? Holding a lens, a child sees the slant black eyes and furry legs of a honeybee whose waggle dance we've been learning to mimic. Released from the boxed-in logic of classrooms, we open to the gifts and surprises of landscape, seasons, weather, wild November gusts that send us wheeling like buzzards, fruiting bodies wearing butter yellow caps, and us, dentist-like with mirrors, inspecting gills white as teeth. Or we find a fleshy earthworm probing leaf litter like a peeled finger. Worm, our top recycler who teaches zero waste in nature. Outdoors, we encounter words, patterns, numbers, infinite lessons in care, symbiosis. Hedges constitute our school. Each wood a state of the earth project, that fallen trunk, the perfect beam for learning balance. With twigs, we build skeletons as anatomically correct as each maker's age or interest can manage. Older children become bigger brothers, sisters. Together, we form a tribe skilled at foraging, firecraft, cooking up stories. Leadership comes in praise, listening, boundaries. Amidst these saplings, I too am learning to grow towards the light. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for listening.
That was brilliant. I was transported in so many points in that. But, Brahan.
Yeah, well, and me too. Thank you so much for that wonderful contribution. I was thinking just how much you drew attention, especially in the earlier part of the talk, to the fact that so much of what we do as conservationists, as gardeners, as human beings, it is about making choices between the things that we love, and that's so difficult. You mentioned wild garlic. I love wild garlic, but I found myself rather ironically at the weekend weeding wild garlic out of the raised bed in which I planted garlic. I make a choice. I have one in one part of the garden, one in the other. And I was also thinking about Catherine Rain, and she cropped up a couple of times, and I was thinking, is love the answer? Was love the answer for her? Because in her story, she, as many of you might know, was the great love of her life was Gavin Maxwell, the author of Ring of Bright Water, which is a line from one of her poems and about his otter, you know, and so many people found that a wonderful thing. Unfortunately, many people in conservation, that was the book that got them started. Unfortunately for Kathleen Rain, there was some kind of incident where she lost his otter, the famous otter, the star of the film and the book, and it died. And they had a falling out, and she blames that for cursing their relationship. And they had to sort of choose between, is it the love of nature or the love of humanity? Is the love they have for each other, or which was the more important, or the love for the otter, for wildlife? And I just wonder how writers, how poets can help us make those choices between the things that we love, when sometimes we can't have both. Is it nature or humanity? Can we love both? And how can poets help us?
Yeah, well, I mean, I think it's a false distinction. You know, we are nature, we are animals, and, you know, the earth is our wider life-sustaining body. And
unfortunately, our culture doesn't do very much to regularly remind us of that. We live in a culture where we see the earth as a sort of infinite resource to be extracted to make money, and you know, we actually, you know, need to really change the way we understand our relationship with the earth, and we need to see ourselves as deeply embedded in an interdependent relationship, and you know, to really inhabit a place of understanding the earth as our wider body.
Mm-hmm. I think that's interesting because we are probably the only species that ever driven itself potentially to its own extinction, which is sort of the route we seem to be heading on at the moment. Can I just reflect on is love the answer? Because I think one of the things that you said in the poem that I've been reflecting on while you were speaking is that the Greeks distinguished a whole different set of kinds of love. You know, we know Eskimos can distinguish different kinds of snow. Ruppin, you were telling me earlier that we probably have somewhere in the region of a couple of hundred words that will describe some aspect of rain
in
the English language. But we have this one word, love, and it's meant to encompass everything. So how do we take the love of Wendell Berry's vision, which actually is about the love of future generations, so that you will do your absolute best to make their lives better, even when you will not see the product of your love. So how do we define love effectively if our language around love is not as great as other? I think there's even more words in Welsh for love than the single component that encompasses so much. Or is it that very encompassing of so much that enables us to use it so widely?
Well, I think we need to invent new words. I mean, in the 90s, you know, being a tree hugger, the whole concept of tree hugging kind of was very current, wasn't it? And I, you know, I'm really keen to introduce everybody to this idea of biophilia. If you haven't heard of it prior to my lecture, hopefully you'll go away with this new word and you'll share it with others. You know, I think it's a very important word, and that idea that, you know, we do have an inherent love of nature and of living systems. But yes, let's invent lots of new words. No, I think we should.
Well, I love your I'm a biophile and incurable, and nor would I care for any cure.
Yes.
We have a couple of minutes if anybody in the audience would like to ask any questions, please. And a microphone coming from behind you.
Mic up, please.
Hello, I'm a teacher, and I'm interested in the growth of forest schools. So why do you think there has been this huge growth in forest schools and the interest in getting children back to nature?
Well, I think that there is a recognition that children really struggle to be in a classroom, you know, for so many hours a day, and that actually it's not very good for them. And we see a massive rise in children, you know, with all kinds of emotional and behavioural issues. And, you know, that we haven't evolved as human beings to be sat, you know, for so many hours still, you know, listening and alert. And it's actually not the best way for anybody to learn. You know, we need to move, we need to be in connection with our bodies as adults as well. You know, it's just a really artificial way of, and not the most effective way at all for anybody to learn. So I think there's just this growing recognition. Obviously, forest school movement has been inspired by the movement in Scandinavia, and we've seen how wonderful it is for we kiddies to go to forest school nurseries, forest nurseries, and, you know, to be outdoors all the time. And it's so important for their development of fine motor skills, gross motor skills. It's just essential to human beings being healthy and well.
Even as a university lecturer, when I take my university students outside, there's always a completely different feeling, a completely different mood, and they love it.
This is the point in a previous life when I had responsibility for education in Wales. My favourite headline ever was "Minister makes children play in the rain," because I introduced a curriculum that required outdoor, and all children aged 3 to 7 in Wales have an outdoor aspect to their education. So anyway, literally one more question, please.
Hi, I'm another teacher. I'm interested in forest schools, but I work in a secondary school, and I very much see it as something that happens in primary schools. I feel quite sad that I don't see any evidence of it with older students. So do you do any work with older young people, and do you have a vision of what it might look like with teenagers?
Yeah, well, I mean, in my lecture, I say about the vision that I have, for young people, which is about, learning, woodland skills, being involved actively in conservation. We face a future where ecosystem restoration is going to be part and parcel of what we have to do. And, it's a wonderful reciprocal relationship that, young people can have, to whether it's going out and litter picking, or it's, learning about, native trees that can be, planted to make a community woodland in their area, or whatever. There's so many ways that young people could be actively involved, and so often young people get really disenchanted with school if they're not very academic, and so many practical skills that young people could learn, being outdoors, bushcraft skills, all the rest of it. So I just think it's because we're so exam-oriented in secondary schools that those opportunities are less frequent. Yeah.
Bracken, a set of topics perhaps for next year's competition?
Well, perhaps, yes. I should just say that as chair of the Association for the Study of Literature and the Environment, which is predominantly an academic organisation in universities, that those of us who are teaching nature writing, literature and environment, literature and sustainability in universities are increasingly taking our students outdoors to find local nature reserves in cities, or those of us who are closer to rural areas, going out into the wilds, Northumberland in my case. And I'm hoping that the next generation of students that we've been training in literature and creative writing departments in the last decade or so will be the next generation of school teachers, and this will spread out and ripple out throughout the country as a whole. And I think this has been some wonderful education-based questions here, just about that. We do run this competition every year, so look out for it. We have a website. I won't ask you to sign up or anything, but it's the ASLE, the Association for Study of Literature and the Environment. We will run this competition again in the autumn, which will be the 7th year next year. We run. In fact, we have been routing, gathering all the previous essays together, perhaps, and publishing them. We don't know yet, but that would be a lovely thing to do. But watch this space. I do hope that you're able to come back next year, but I can't tell you who it will be next year, because we haven't yet run the competition, and it's a mystery to us as much as it is to you. But I think we'd like to say thank you very much to Helen for a wonderful talk, and of course to Inspire and the Hay Festival for supporting this.
Yes, thank you so much. Thank you. I think this is, we always describe this audience as small but perfect performers. Because this is, I think that if you were to have an opportunity to see all the lectures, just the breadth of exciting creativity linked to literature and the environment that's going on inside or out with our universities. And I should have said, I was telling you about, Helen at the age of 2, and forgot to mention that, of course, she's got a master's from Edinburgh University and participates in ASLE. But thank you all so much for coming today. These will be online, both on the ASLE UKI website and on the Inspire website. And there will be a video of the whole event, so you'll be able to hear Helen both reading others and most especially her own poetry again in your own time. So thank you very much, Joch Bauer, and enjoy your time.
should.